Thank you, dear technicians, that have left some light on this morning so I can see you. Good morning. How's everyone this morning? Lovely. And yet another challenge this morning now we have is a study of the cause. And very interesting the way all this fits together. And this was a very lucid presentation, I thought, from the chair of the National Assembly about the focus of the plan. Very, very important that we be evolving and keeping alert and au courant with where the processes are going. And we don't always see the end vision right away. It takes time, but that was very illuminating. Thank you. I can only repeat what I mentioned to you before, that my own understanding of what I'm doing, I'm kind of, some people say old school, you know, the old way of doing things. But what my intention is that we also bear in mind our individual responsibilities. We have these terrific injunctions from Baha'u'llah calling us to immerse ourselves in the ocean of the words of God. And these things should be constantly part of our lives, not simply when we attend activities, but everything else is connected together. And this is the source of the energy that fuels all the other activities that we have. Shoghi Effendi also said, and I think that depends very much on prayer, meditation, and study, that the cause, the administration of the cause, the very processes, if you will, collective processes of the plan that you're examining in the messages of the House of Justice and in these studies that you have, has to be lubricated with love. Love is the thing that makes everything work. And love, the source of love, really comes from these simple actions of prayer, meditation, and study. We get that, and also we have a collective source of that. But I mean, I noticed I copied something from the UK Baha'i newsletter, which I think is one of the most beautiful ones in the world. Baha'u'llah said, "In every breast which committeth his words to memory, God shall cause, if it were that of a believer, to be filled with his love." We're going to get to this point of memorization of writings. The first we've ever done that is in the Institute courses. But the challenge I mentioned to you, Mr. Khatam telling us to memorize the Quran, is something we need to bear in mind. Not that we maybe necessarily get to the stage of memorizing the Quran, but we have the whole question of at least committing more of the writings and words of Baha'u'llah and the prayers of Baha'u'llah and Abdul Baha to memory. I would commend to you, with regard to this particular subject, a compilation. This is just my personal copy of it, but it's called The Importance of Deepening Our Knowledge and Understanding of the Faith. It was prepared by the Universal House of Justice by a research department under the direction of the House of Justice. And it's the most comprehensive coverage of the question of what we need to study, how we need to study, what we need to put attention to in our individual education of the cause, to ourselves, teaching ourselves the cause of God. Baha'u'llah's command, teach ye the cause of God. And if you arise to teach, first teach your own self, so that your words will take effect in the hearts of the friends. In other words, absorbing the words of God, the teachings of God, and then transforming them in our lives into actions that will be the source of attracting others and confirming others. This is the secret. And we're coming, of course, to this question of action tomorrow in support of all these various activities that have been described to us this morning. The section I'd like to refer to first here are the letters of Shoghi Effendi himself to the believers. introducing the concept of deepening ourselves in the literature of the cause, coming to know the basic Baha'i books. And the ones he stresses are the Book of Certitude, the Kitab-e-Iqan, Some Answered Questions, and Nabil's narrative in the earlier stages. Later on he adds God Passes By, because it's such a comprehensive review of everything in the cause and gives us as clear a picture as we're ever going to have of the first century of the Baha'i Faith. And that, of course, includes the heroic age and the ministries of the founders of the faith and of the center of the covenant. Brilliant distillation of all of the various literature we have of the cause, and also through the Guardian's vision, he puts the various epochs and events and developments of the cause in the right perspective, one with another. Otherwise, we can read one, we get totally carried away with that, but there are counterbalances. There are truths that are at the opposite ends of the globe, as Shoghi Effendi says in one of his letters. And if you really read the literature and comprehend the teachings of the faith, you find these things are connected in different ways. At first, they may sound like they're saying to do the opposite things. There's so many things that we need to do all at the same time. We have to get all that straightened out. But in this section, my own reading of it and looking at it with the youth in the world centered over the years, it reveals a certain suggested pattern. At least one could understand it in that manner. The first of the things he's calling us to do is to read the literature. Pick up the books and read them. Then he says we should read and reread the literature. The friends told me that at one session of the pilgrims in the time of the Guardian, he had asked the pilgrims if they had read the Kitab-e-Iqan. And they went around the table and one man said, yes, he'd done it. Shoghi Effendi didn't say anything, but the next pilgrim group, he said, I asked the friends about if they had read and were studying the Kitab-e-Iqan. And he said, one man, I can confess it was a Westerner, it was an American, said that he'd done it. And Shoghi Effendi said, you can't do the Iqan, it doesn't ever finish, you know. You need to be reading and rereading. So just in case you say, well, I already read the Iqan when I was a youth and now I'm an adult and I've done that. No, not quite. We have to come back. We are a new creation almost every minute, if you say. God said, Baha'u'llah says in the Tablet of Wisdom, he recreates creation. It's recreated from instant to instant so fast that you don't know it's being recreated. And you're in the process of immense possibilities, potentials, and developments. And so after a week, after a year, after being tested by the other believers, after being tested by God, after being tested by your own silly mistakes, you come to a greater understanding of the text. Your vision broadens. So you want to revisit it. I was just hearing people saying that we're rereading something the other day, and they said, every time we read it, we find passages that we've never seen before. We know we've read it before, and we know we've studied it before, but new things come out. And that's because of this torrents, Abdu'l-Baha says, rivers surging within the verses of God. If we become receptive to it, they start flooding our consciousness and exchanging our old ways of seeing with new ways of seeing. And Shoghi Effendi says very clearly, he says, the more that one studies the cause, the more one realizes that their previous notions were erroneous. It's a bit sobering at times. You look and you say, I thought I understood this, but now I see but my limited understanding was not at all what it should be. But now I understand. Until next week when you reread the passage again. So we have reading and rereading. Then he goes on and he says we should delve painstakingly. Painstakingly involves a little bit of effort, a little bit of hurt, maybe trying to apply ourselves. It means finding a space in our day to turn our thoughts and attention, besides just reading, to the prayers of the faith, to study the literature, and perhaps we need to systematize that in a way so we can gradually work through these basic books along in our own spiritual lives and vision. Read, reread, delve painstakingly. Then he says we should digest the contents of these major books. That takes a lot of chewing. It takes a lot of effort, you know, phrase by phrase. Personally, in my life, I found that it was often important to have notebooks or different sections in the same notebook to take down notes. Something about the soul, something about immortality, something about vision of the future, whatever it is that attracts you, take out those verses and put them down, write them down. The very fact that you identify them, that you then write them and keep them, reread them yourself, is a very important kind of process of individual study. After digestion, Shoghi Effendi says that the friends must master the contents of these books, upping the ante, if you will. So we have rereading, reading, rereading, delving, digesting, mastering, and finally, at the final stage, he says, and the friends should commit passages of the holy writings to memory. And that carried to the ultimate of Mr. Khatam saying, memorize whole books, you know. I know we had a wonderful friend from Iran who was heading the archives department, taking care of the texts of the faith. And she'd memorized, in Arabic, had memorized the Kitab-i Aqdas. And she was not alone in that. There was a class in Iran, and they did that. It all sounds a bit impossible to us in the West. We're not so used to that. Although I think physicians, those studying medicine, have to learn so many terms of anatomy and physiology that they have already prepared themselves in a certain way to try to hold on, to memorize these various verses. So that's that. Now, I mentioned to you that Mr. Olenga had it stressed by the guardian to him how important it was to study the talks of Abdu'l-Bahá, to absorb those talks and the way, the approach that he had in teaching. And Abdu'l-Bahá, when we look at his collective talks and everything, we see there was a terrific reasoning process going on. He said what we say should be rational. It should be supported by proofs. This particular compilation of the House of Justice, they've translated a number of new passages of Abdu'l-Bahá with respect to gathering the proofs. Not only is this important for the effect of your teaching on others, but the effect it has on your own self, of straightening out, of combing your own understanding of the faith, making it properly balanced. This is from a newly translated tablet at that time. When your hearts are wholly attracted to the one true God, you will acquire divine knowledge. You will become attentive to the proofs and testimonies, and will commit to memory the glad tidings concerning the manifestations of the beauty of the All-Merciful, as mentioned in the heavenly scriptures. Then ye shall behold how wondrous are his confirmations, and how gracious is his assistance. And again, in this day there is nothing more important than the instruction and study of clear proofs and convincing heavenly arguments, for therein lie the source of life and the path of salvation. The besides those central books, there is a great emphasis in this particular compilation and in a number of passages that I know about the hidden words of Baha'u'llah. Very useful because it's transportable. They're short enough that you can start your processes of memorization, besides the passages that you're finding in the Ruhi courses. Add these questions of the hidden words. Adwa says, "It behooveth us one and all to recite day and night both the Persian and Arabic hidden words, to pray fervently and supplicate tearfully that we may be enabled to conduct ourselves in accordance with these divine counsels. These holy words have not been revealed to be heard, but to be practiced." Again, back to this concept of reading the holy writings should result in action. We should memorize the hidden words, Abdu'l-Bahá's admonition to us. Follow the exhortations of the incomparable Lord and conduct ourselves in a manner which befitteth our servitude at the threshold of the one true God. In another place he says, "Be assured in thyself that if thou dost conduct thyself in accordance with the hidden words revealed in Persian and in Arabic, thou shalt become a torch of the fire of the love of God, and an embodiment of humility, of lowliness, of evanescence, of selflessness." And finally, the hidden words is a treasury of divine mysteries. When thou ponderest its contents, the doors of the mysteries will open. What wonderful promises he has here. He goes on to, Abdu'l-Bahá himself was stressing the major book of tablets after the Kitab-i Aqdas, the importance of reading the Tarazat, the Kalamat, the Tajaliyat, Ishraqat. All these things that are there. Gradually one wants to make a personal study plan, I think, to move from tablet to tablet and review these things. Finally, he says, "There are certain pillars which have been established as the unshakable supports of the faith of God. The mightiest of these is learning and the use of the mind, the expansion of consciousness and insight into the realities of the universe and the hidden mysteries of Almighty God." Some of you recall a marvelous passage from Abdu'l-Bahá where he speaks about God being the author of two books. Two books? You know, there's a lot in the bookstore, but he talks about two books. One, he says, is the book of Revelation. And the other, he says, is the book of the universe, the book of the open tablet of existence. And God has created, revealed, and sustained both processes. And he says they are in full accordance, the one with the other. The physical world, the outer universe, the creation of itself, is the mirror image of the higher kingdom. And the revelation of God is the manifestation from the higher kingdom to us. He says, when you read the verses of the book of Revelation, you will penetrate the significances and meanings of the book of creation, the outer book of existence. And when you read and study the book of creation, that is your own education and your process of scientific learning and so on, that will give you insights into the book of Revelation. There's this balance. It's like back to the civilization has both science and religion to cause it to soar and sail. So you want to balance these two and realize that they interact with each other. And if there's any point where one of them contradicts the other, well, we see that in the history of religion, the prophets have made pronouncements that it took a while for humanity to catch up with. And we kind of have to look at the sciences we study in those lights to understand, for instance, the conundrum in science about the missing link, searching for the missing link. Abdu'l-Bahá says it will never be found. So I don't know if I'd want to dedicate all my university studies to trying to find it. You know, there are certain things that suggest to us one career or another career of study from looking at the writings. How many times the parents and youth ask about what should our children study? What's important to study? And I think we need to examine the writings and see where things are going, what have been suggested. When we see universal language, right, there's an area of terrific application. The learning about auxiliary languages, following the processes of the history of that, and thinking about defining maybe a newly created language, all that's going on out there, and something the Baha'is could take part in. Another thing is that he says there should be fresh water delivered to every person that lives on the planet, all of the villages everywhere in the world. That becomes, you know, something quite significant in developing the production and maintenance and conservation of water, so on and so forth. As you read the writings, these things will jump out at you, and you'll see things that are there. We need Baha'is to study archival processes. Just the World Center alone, it's hard to find people who can come that can preserve the physical basis for the revelation of the cause. So you may feel a calling in that direction. And I think we can, you know, look a bit beyond the insistence that we should be either an engineer or a doctor or a lawyer. There are variations in this in the world. And actually, the medicine, while it's very important, has become very politicized in the world in different ways. And the Baha'is that think they're going to study medicine and then they're going to be able to go anywhere and serve anywhere, yes, they will be able to, but they won't be able to practice medicine. You get a degree here or in the United States, and when you go abroad, they won't recognize you because they're jealous of the capacity of these nations to have produced sound medical practitioners, and they don't want the competition. If you were in Bolivia, you know, and you wanted to go to a doctor, and there was a doctor from the UK there practicing, wouldn't you probably choose him? Just because you know that the studies are more advanced in some parts of the world than another. Now they don't say you can't practice, they just say you have to take our course of studies and qualify, which takes another 10 years of your life. So unlikely that's going to work out. Public health is a little bit, it gives you a little bit broader access through international agencies and institutions to serve. This is important. I see a lot of, you know, the young people are here, junior youth are starting to think about where are they going to go with their lives, what they like to study. Broaden through the writings of the faith, through the study of the cause, broaden your knowledge of what the needs of the future are going to be. Mr. Olinga had a different way of speaking with the Baha'is than he had with the with public talks. And this is something else you can see in the writings and talks of the Master. Very interesting to witness how he encouraged everyone, but he encouraged in different ways. Always with the public, he's bringing proofs and evidences. Either the, you realize that Abdu'l-Bahá was facing the same materialistic outlook of the mass of people that we have today. Well, it's stronger today, even more than before. And he gives us the means for awakening people, drawing them out of that very materialistic view. You know, Shoghi Effendi said the greatest enemy of the cause is materialism. That is the greatest enemy. Why is that? Because having been raised in this very materialistic outlook on life, people don't see the importance of religion. And then if they take a careful look at the existing religions, of course they get turned off by all the negative elements. Why has Baha'u'llah come? He's come because the old religions have all been corrupted and changed, altered from what they were originally. Abdu'l-Bahá says people are holding to superstitions and false ideas. Actually, sometimes it's easier to speak with the atheists than it is with followers, fanatical followers of other religions, simply because they're on a sounder basis. Mr. Furtan tells a story. He said that when he was a Baha'i youth, he went to university in Moscow. Okay, this is very challenging. This was in the early days of the revolution, and nobody was allowed to believe in God, if you can imagine such a thing. it was just impossible to ever reveal such a thing or have such an idea in your head. And he had a roommate with him that became suspicious of him, that he had his quiet moments. He was very silent, quiet, and he had a certain joy present in his life and in his outlook. So one day the roommate challenged him. He said, "You believe in God, don't you?" Mr. Furtan very wisely said, "I don't believe in the God that you don't believe in." Which is exactly the case of the atheists, you know. What they think is God, or what they think people think is God, we don't believe that either. We have a whole different approach. Now, the study of the definition of what knowledge of God is, what are the characteristics of the Creator and of creation that would give you confidence in the existence of God without being able to encompass and know directly the source of divinity itself, are all covered in Abdu'l Bahá's talks and in the teachings of the faiths. Very important for us to absorb these things. How can we attract thinking people if we don't know the teachings? You know, Abdu'l Bahá states it very clearly. He says, "How can the poor give to the poor?" The whole idea, if you're going to offer a spiritual offering to people, you have to possess it yourself. You have to have absorbed it. You have to have digested it. You have to have mastered it. You have to have memorized it, so to speak. He gives us a whole program, if you will, of how we should approach this dimension of these four challenges. I want to, in this light, switch themes a little bit and quote to you from a marvelous letter of Shoghi Effendi to a Baha'i youth. He says, "The problem," this was written in 1935, way back, "the problem with which you are faced is one which concerns and seriously puzzles many of our present day youth. How to attain spirituality is indeed a question to which every young man and woman must sooner or later try to find a satisfactory answer. It is precisely because no such satisfactory answer has been given or found that the modern youth finds itself bewildered and is being consequently carried away by the materialistic forces that are so powerfully undermining the foundation of man's moral and spiritual life. Questions are rising in the school and that we're facing in all of our dealings with junior youth and everything, but questions of chastity and moral behavior and so on. Again, materialism has removed all the constraints." And speaking with the animators in California, they were saying that one of the main challenges they have in dealing with junior youth is the influence of the outer society on all these youth in questions of morality and sexual behavior. And all the songs that say love is the way, you know. But love is the way they interpret in sexual terms. So it's very confusing to our young people. And we have to come up with these marvelous teachings and advices which tend to hold the youth within a spiritual pattern. "Indeed, the chief reason for the evils now rampant in society is the lack of spirituality. The materialistic civilization of our age has so much absorbed the energy and interest of mankind that people in general do no longer feel the necessity of raising themselves above the forces and conditions of their daily material existence." And friends, I think we all realize how that threatens us too, because the constant view of life, the way society deals with it, the way the media deals with it, the news we receive, the literature and novels that we might read, if you have any time left after engagement with the activities of the planet, all these things keep telling us life is something other than what the writings tell us. So we need to be refreshing ourselves constantly. The universal crisis affecting mankind is therefore essentially spiritual in its causes. The spirit of the age taken on the whole is irreligious. Man's outlook on life is too crude and materialistic to enable him to elevate himself into the higher realms of the spirit. We realize that's what we're about. The whole Hidden Words is to lift us into another way of seeing, is to realize that we have another aspect to our beings, which is veiled and darkened by our attachment to this world, by our attachment to a materialistic outlook, by viewing everything in terms of the best advantage for me, the me generation, so to speak, there are people talking about. Over and over in the writings it says, pride, self-love, and passion, and desire are the veils that keep the inner reality, our inner reality, from shining forth, from coming into our outer consciousness. We want to change our consciousness from awareness of the materialistic viewpoint of life. We want to transform that into a way of seeing the great spiritual blessings and powers and bounties latent within us, so they start streaming forth. And Abdu'l-Bahá says, you know, you should become incarnate light. I was mentioning that to you in the Tablets of the Divine Plan. He says that. Incarnate light, what's that? That people should see us shining. That, like Mr. Olingo, who gets out and walks in the street in a town, the whole place is moved by that. When we go out of the house every day, it would be nice if we produce that kind of effect, wouldn't it? It is this condition, so sadly morbid, into which society has fallen, that religion seeks to improve and transform. For the core of religious faith is that mystic feeling which unites man with God. This state of spiritual communion can be brought about and maintained by means of meditation and prayer. Our old friends you're seeing here. And this is the reason why Baha'u'llah has so much stressed the importance of worship. It is not sufficient for a believer merely to accept and observe the teachings. Not sufficient to accept and observe the teachings. He should, in addition, cultivate the sense of spirituality, which he can chiefly acquire by means of prayer. The Baha'i faith, like all other religions, is thus fundamentally mystic in character. Its chief goal is the development of the individual and society through the acquisition of spiritual powers and virtues. It is the soul of man which has first to be fed, and this spiritual nourishment prayer can best provide. And finally, he ends with a very strong statement. He says, laws and institutions as viewed by Baha'u'llah can become really effective only when our inner spiritual life has been perfected and transformed. Otherwise, religion will degenerate into a mere organization and become a dead thing. The believers, particularly the young ones, should therefore fully realize the necessity of praying. For prayer is absolutely indispensable to their inner spiritual development. And this, as already stated, is the very foundation and purpose of the religion of God. We know in our discussions with the public oftentimes, religion is viewed as a bad term, as it's something negative in society. We have to redeem and redefine religion for the seekers and for those that we're in touch with when we can. And this, Baha'u'llah is telling us, comes principally from a life which includes prayer as its basis. The verses, one verse of Islam that Baha'u'llah quotes, you remember, in the beginning of the Seven Valleys, he says, "Whoso maketh efforts for us in our ways, will we assuredly guide them." Now, the action, service part, our involvement in the plan, confirms the truth of that in our lives. And then we realize more and more the importance of meditation, the importance of prayer, the importance of raising our own individual spiritual vision, spirituality of our own lives, as a basis for remaining energetic and also remaining positive in carrying out the various communal and collective duties that are falling to our lot. The future of the cause, I think, depends on the combination of these various factors in our lives. We have a few minutes more, and nothing is right at the top of my mind to want to say to you. Do you have any questions that you want to ask about on this subject, or on either on prayer meditation or on study of the writings that you'd like to have addressed?
How valuable is it to pray your own words? I know that it's obviously better to use the Baha'i writings or
Baha'i prayers. Yes. Did you hear the question? How valuable is it to recite prayers in our own words? Sometimes that can be very effective. There's nothing against it, but the verses of Baha'u'llah where he says, you know, he's revealed the praise of God, the praise wherewith God praises his own self. Because of revelation, those are the words that are most appropriate in prayer. And sometimes our own prayers are limited in scope. So I think it's a question of balance between the two. Sometimes you find yourself reaching or just formulating your own words, "Oh God, help me with this thing," or whatever it is that's bothering us. And we should feel able to approach God and speak directly to Baha'u'llah in our meditations and in our prayers. He's there, where are we? You know the question. But I think that certainly we don't have such things in our houses of worship nor in our meetings. We should be, I think, magnanimous. If we have seekers who are amongst us and they offer prayers in their own words, to be understanding of that process, but to gradually wean them away from such a thing in public gatherings, in devotional gatherings. Devotional gatherings should be focused again on scripture. Discussion is fine, everything. But that's the way I understand it. I hope that might be helpful. Any other questions? Yes.
Thank you very much for your marvelous talks. I think we've all really learned so much from you, so thank you very much. Could you just comment briefly on, in terms of studying the books that you mentioned, like the Igon, could you comment briefly on the value of studying them together as opposed to just studying them privately, or if there is any value in that?
Oh, I think certainly there is value in that. I mean, we all learn from each other and from the misunderstandings, you know, the insights we may have on the scripture. There's certainly no limitation on having study classes on these books together. House presently urging in smaller groups rather than making a national campaign or something like that. We have the 5-year plan of the House of Justice that we should be doing. But that certainly for individuals who want to be together, or if you find it's easier to study if you read with somebody else or with a small group, they're certainly welcome to do that. I think there's certainly a value in that. studying with people who've studied the book previously and have perhaps a greater sense of its the organization and the emphasis that needs to be looked at. I myself always like to take Shoghi Effendi as the guide in studying anything. If he's commented on it, then that's a terrific aid to us. And in God Passes By, he reviews the major contents of the Agon, some 19 points if you look at them and write them out. And then when you're reading the book, put down the paragraph numbers behind those 19 points. That gives you is a terrific aid in study, a focus to be looking for things. Then you identify those major themes and you look at them, and that's easier than sometimes, you know, lulling yourself into a happy state of I've read 10 pages, but I don't remember a thing, you know. So you have that challenge. So I think both ways are open to us. Yeah. And certainly, I know that the House of Justice has encouraged in the American Baha'i community that guidelines of Shoghi Effendi with regard to summer school content should be kept in mind. We have a balance, you know, between aspects of the plan, which I think is the way the school is planned here, it's very good, and that we would want to continue to not lose sight of the ocean of the revelation upon which the ship of the cause of God, the plan of God, the five-year plan is sailing. If we don't have any water in the ocean, it's going to hit dry land. And when you have people complaining that, you know, there's so much routine and there's no inspiration, the point is that we have that individual responsibility to bring to the activities, the more organized activities of the faith, it seems to me. Yes, please.
In our community, you know, we have so many new, young people coming into the faith, and they're coming in through the Ruhi process, and they're engaged, and everybody is so busy and active. And after the July 1st letter, there was a group of youth that started asking for the Dawnbreakers, because it's that first paragraph where it's referred. You know, English isn't their first language, so even the Dawnbreakers is daunting, but we stop every paragraph to make sure everybody's together. And so would that be a wise thing? As you said that, I thought, gee, instead of wondering where to go, maybe.
Well, I don't think a house is ever going to tell you not to study those things. Obviously, this is the basis of our faith. But how it weaves into community activities, and then you may want to consult with the National Assembly and seek their advice on the subject. Get somebody to help you with the pronunciation of the Persian names. I know there's a young man in the West that he's created a formula for that. Take about 20 minutes and go through these, how the vowels, the long vowels and the short vowels, and pronounce this and pronounce that, and let us all pronounce five times together this. And he goes through that for about 20 minutes, and then he has them read a list of all these various Persian phrases, and it starts coming out. And then people, when they're reading the writings of Olson and then what's his name, and they jump over the name, you know, because after a while you lose track of who is who and what's happening. Where are they going, and how? What actions are they taking? It becomes very confusing. So the names are really important, and you know, just calling him Mullah is not enough. You know? You've got to know which Mullah this is, and where he's from. On top of that, so that's a good place, I think, to get somebody to help with that, that actually knows how to pronounce the names.
Release the Song by Mr. Bill Sears is a shorter version and more understanding.
Yes, certainly more accessible to some people. Yeah, it's a good place to start, but you don't want to sell the Dawnbreaker short. Why did Shoghi Effendi take, you know, such a long period at the very inception, prior to launching the Divine Plan, to give this book? He says in one wonderful letter, he says, it's not only a book of history, it's a book of meditation. Because in understanding what motivated these people to do what they, that becomes the example for us. fact, I think that a dose of the Dawnbreakers in any national community will energize everything. But it has to be weighed in with all the other.
Now, perhaps the easier version may be a good start. But any other particular book of Shoghi Effendi, please, or any other guidance you would have if they wanted simultaneous with the Ruhi process, deeper themselves in the faith?
There's an endless sea of other writings. I think that we've lost sight a bit of the dispensation of Baha'u'llah, a letter by Shoghi Effendi, that is full of Baha'i essentials, is full of the fundamental verities of the faith that Shoghi Effendi says all the Baha'is should know and be aware of. Some of those are reflected in the Ruhi courses, but it's also very helpful to focus on that document at some stage in their personal development. I know before we were allowed to become Baha'is back in the 50s, you had to read the Dispensation of Baha'u'llah, the New Era, the Will and Testament of Abdu'l-Bahá. These were essentials. And they told me that the LSA will quiz you on their content when you meet them. I thought it was a welcoming meeting. You know, I went in a very nervous fashion to the meeting. And fortunately, they didn't ask me when Mullah Hossein was born. And I got through the questions and answers. Nobody said whether the answers were right or not. They smiled politely and they said, the house is very small and we need to consult confidentially. Would you mind standing in the street? It was quite a cold night. And I spent 40 minutes in the street waiting for them to decide whether I could be a Baha'i or not. At least I thought that was what was going on. And when they invited me back in, the chairman apologized so much. He said, I'm sorry we took so long. I looked down and said, what's the decision going to be? And he said, but the assembly hadn't met for months and we had a number of small businesses we had to take care of. And we wanted to say the closing prayer with you. You almost lost me, you know. I didn't live too far. I could have gone home. Anyway, friends, it's not quite that difficult to become a Baha'i now. And then that's just getting in the door. Then after that, you have to try to become a Baha'i on top of all of it, you know, which we're just talking about, and which is the subject of tomorrow's consultation. That is prayer, meditation, study, and now action. What kind of action has to result from this? And the house has been stressing how all of our study should result in action and movement. This is a fundamental from Abdu'l-Bahá's time. You heard what he said about the hidden words are not just to be read, but to be lived. Thank you very much.